All right. Hello, everyone. Hi, everyone. Can you guys hear me? Okay, good, good. Well, I hope everyone's has is having a great weekend. Good evening or good morning. All right, so we will talk about Xi Jinping's economic blueprint and political priorities for 2023. He held the first Politburo meeting after the Party Congress on December 6th. The November meeting was, they hold this meeting monthly. The November meeting was really just an extension of the Party Congress. So this December meeting was really the first Politburo meeting after the Party Congress. And I compare the official statement released for this meeting and compare it to the statement from the Politburo meeting from last December. So I compare the same meeting in December between 2022 and 2021, and I think it revealed his two top challenges as well as priorities. So right now, Xi Jinping faces two challenges: the economy, and also increased internal political infighting. So today, we'll discuss. We have three-part discussions. First, we'll quickly review the Chinese economy. Then we'll talk about his priority number one, which is his economic blueprint for 2022. I'll show you the comparisons. I did a few charts that show you side by side the 2021 vision or his vision to the 2022. And then we'll talk about his priority number two, which is upcoming political cleansing. So first, we'll talk about the economy. China's dismal economy is alarming. In the real estate sector, Evergrande has a listed debt of 2 trillion renminbi, and its usurious financial products amount to another 1 trillion renminbi. And plus, there's a $300 billion debt. So if you add them all up, that's over 4 trillion renminbi. And other real estate companies, like Sunet China, has 1.2 trillion debt. Wanke has 1.4 trillion. Country Garden has 2 trillion. So most of these companies' stocks have been suspended from the exchanges. In the U.S., they would have been bankrupt a while ago, but in China, the government does not let them go bankrupt and has been trying to save them by issuing successive administrative orders to prevent the real estate prices from falling fast. A media personality in Taiwan described it this way, and I think it's more than accurate. He said that the real estate sector is like a stage four cancer for the CCP. And rather than having a big surgery to remove the cancer, the CCP has delayed treatment and continuously fed to the cancerous cells. So it will eventually become a destructive force that will terminate the Chinese economy and the regime. And linked to the real estate problem is the local government debt. I've done a couple of videos on that already, but today I just want to quickly mention a few things. The local government bonds reached a record high in October, and local government bonds are divided into the general bonds and the special bonds. The special bonds have no, the general bonds have no revenue and are paid by the government budget, but the special bonds are supposedly should generate revenue and should have income. And this is the type of bonds that local government issued to build quarantine camps that I mentioned in my last video, the video that I released on Friday, December the 5th. So basically, the special bonds are known as the Chinese version of the municipal bonds. It started in 2015, but has grown so fast, and it has now accounted for 59% of the total local government bonds. And we know what connects the local government debt to the real estate is the land sales, right? Land concession is an important part of the revenue for local governments. And but in you know it has declined significantly. Wall Street Journal reported on the 18th of November that, based on China's own data, the land sales has fell 36% in the first 10 months of this year. And in the northeast province of Jilin, land sale revenue declined 76%. And Yunnan province in the south fell by 59%. So basically, private property developers that once aggressively bid on lands, such as Evergrande, Sunac, they're in financial distress, so they stopped buying lands. And state-owned companies, or SOEs, are filling the void. So how they do this? They collaborate with the banks and borrow money through the LGFV platform, the local government financing vehicles, or some call it the local government hidden debt platform. And then, so what this means is local government-owned SOEs borrow money from government-owned banks to generate revenue for the government. And then the revenue is recorded on the books, right, as land concessions. But the borrowing part from the LGFVs are not recorded on the book as liabilities. So you see how the local government just basically took out money from the banks and show it on their book as revenue without showing the liabilities. And it does not generate anything, right? So, but they need the land concession money to pay for the massive COVID tests, the quarantine programs and all of that. But it significantly increases the risk for the banks. So even with the help of this fictitious land concession, local governments aren't able to balance its book. So for the first half of the year, local government's total fiscal revenue was more than 13.5 trillion RMB, and its fiscal expenditures was almost 19 trillion. So you have a deficit of 5.5 trillion yuan. That's 40% in the red. And this is the case across all 31 provinces. Now, the wealthiest because China has 31 provinces and direct municipal cities, like Shanghai is the biggest one and the wealthiest one. Shanghai, which has always been able to contribute net income to the central government, it does not rely on the central government's transfer payment to balance its book. This year had a deficit of 1.8 trillion yuan. And it's the only region with a deficit of that's less than 10 trillion yuan. So you can see how bad it is, you know, if that's the situation for Shanghai. So throughout, you know, with the help of the fictitious land concessions, it's still bad. And meanwhile, exports are down. CNBC reported on December 4th that the U.S. manufacturing orders in China fell by 40%, and it has forced Chinese factories to start the Chinese New Year holidays 2 weeks earlier. We've also heard that Apple is planning to move its manufacturing out of China due to the recent meltdown at Foxconn. And also heard that Tesla will stop production from the end of this month, from the end of December to early January in its Shanghai Gigafactory due to declined demand on Model 3. And also Model Y in China. So you see, all of that, you know, these are seriously economic challenges that Xi Jinping faces. So now let me share with you. So December 6th, let me talk about this Politburo meeting. So December 6th, was the day where he delivered the eulogy, or he hosted the memorial service for his political enemy, Jiang Zemin, right? It was the 6th. So in the morning, they held the funeral service for Jen, and then in the afternoon, they had this Politburo meeting. And then on the following day, he went to Middle East for his trip. So I just want to give you a little background information on when this meeting was held. So this meeting was held, and I'm going to show you that two top priorities that came out of this meeting are, number one, the economy, and number two is political cleansing in the name of anti-corruption. And the COVID is no longer his top priority for 2023. All right, so let me show you this slides. Okay, so what I did is, maybe this is better. This is even bigger, yeah. So I did a comparison between the December 6, 2022 Politburo meeting to the December 6th, it somehow fell on the same day from 2021. So, and I kind of summarize the verbiage, the report used, and by I kind of summarize them by categories. So, for example, review of the past year in 2021. Xi Jinping calls the year a milestone year in the history of the party and our country. But in 2022, he called that an extremely important year. Whatever he meant by extremely important, he probably meant it's extremely challenging. So that's the difference when he described the 2 years. And when it comes to the pandemic, last year, you know, basically the direction for the country is, or the direction for 2022 was just adhere to the policy of, you know, the policy was to prevent importing external cases while preventing domestic rebound of cases. That was kind of the policy they set for themselves at the end of last year. So, you know, the document basically said we continue to adhere to, you know, stick to that policy. And then you know, conduct the COVID prevention work scientifically and with target, whatever that means. It's just very vague, but, you know, general CCP language to say continue, carry on with the current policy. However, for the latest meeting, it has changed. It has changed it to optimize prevention measures and then better balance COVID control and economic and social development. So now he has incorporated, you know, economic development into the pandemic work. So now he wants to balance the two. So that's, I think, a dramatic change. And when it comes to the economic direction or the overall direction for the country, last year it still used, you know, it still referenced reforms and opening up. It said comprehensively conduct in-depth reforms and opening up. And that changed completely this year. It says China would solidly push for the development of Chinese-style modernization, whatever that means, right? So this is new jargon that he now uses to describe the direction of China. So no more reforms and opening up, but he's now welcoming Chinese-style modernization. And when it comes to priorities, last year they would stabilize the microeconomy. And now it's pushed the economy to a positive cycle. I think in Chinese, you could also translate push the economy or turn the economy into a productive direction. You could also say it that way. And then he changed from maintain the economic operation in a reasonable range. Now he's more specific. He says achieve effective improvement in quality and reasonable growth in quantity. And then the last year's priority was to maintain social stability for the party Congress. And now he wants to have a good start for comprehensively building a modern socialist country. I think this is this goes back to the Chinese style modernization. I think by that he meant to build a modern socialist China. So that's just a kind of a comparison between the 2 years at a high level. And then I'll go into this is the comparison when it comes to economy. So this is his economic blueprint for 2023. So when it comes to domestic economy, last year he just said continue to do a good job to maintain the six stabilities and six protections. That's the kind of the direction the CCP has set from 2018 to 2020. I'll explain what the six stabilities are and what the six protections are, and then continue to improve people's life and living conditions. It's just very general. Whereas now he is more specific. He's talking about improve market confidence because he's lacking that. And focus on the stability of growth, employment, and pricing. So instead of focusing on, maybe I should show you what the, here's the six stabilizing and six protections. So the six stabilizing is stabilizing employment, stabilizing the financial sector, stabilizing foreign trade, foreign investment, domestic investment, and stabilizing expectation management. That's, I think, very interesting. I think he's saying he does not want to see any surprises. Okay, we'd better manage expectations, both domestically and also internationally. And the six stabilizations came from the July Politburo meeting from 2018. Okay, and then the six insures, the six protections, came from the April 2020 Politburo meetings. I think that's after the outbreak of the pandemic, right? April was the time when it quickly spread to the rest of the world. So that's when the CCP raised these new jargons for its economic or political priorities. Excuse me. So these are the six stabilization and six insures. So going back, last December, the meeting basically said we continue to follow that direction, right? By maintaining the six stabilities and six insures, and we'll continue to improve people's life. Well, yeah. Now, instead of saying all the, you know, insures, he's focusing on growth, employment, and pricing. So he got rid of all the other ones, and he wants to focus on the stability of growth, stability of employment, and stability of pricing. And also, he wants to effectively prevent and disintegrate major crises. So, you know, that was not in the verbiage last year. So now he specifically talk about prevent them, disintegrate any major crisis. Now, for supply chain, finance, and foreign trade, I thought it's also interesting. He mentioned opening up, but he said promote high-level opening up to the outside world. And I'm trying to guess, you know how CCP's language sometimes very, it's just full of jargons and you don't know what they mean because it's very vague. So I'm trying to figure out what he meant by a high level. I think he meant probably high quality or like, you know, we want to have a targeted opening up. We're not opening up to everyone, but we're going to open up to those people who could produce the most results or give us the best results, or those most important companies or industries or organizations. I think that's what he meant by high level. So he thinks China will continue. He's saying that China will continue to open up to those high level organizations or companies or industries, right? But with great efforts to attract and use foreign investments. He now want to attract foreign investments because he's running out of money. I just showed you the debt problem is a big problem. So he wants to actively attract foreign investments, but he wants to limit the scope to the most important or the most crucial sectors. And then the second bullet point is to effectively prevent and dissolve major economic and financial risks and guard against systemic risks. And that wasn't in the language from last year. And also, he mentioned enhance the resilience and security of industrial supply chains. So this year, it becomes a lot more focused. These couple of bullet points are like what he really want to focus on. If you look at last year's, the verbiage is a lot longer. For example, last year, he talked about real estate. There's no mentioning of real estate in this year's meeting. I didn't see it. Last year, he talked about real estate. He also talked about enhanced national strategic scientific strength. He talked a lot about high tech, national, those strategic scientific developments. He talked a lot about that. They are not in this year's language. So you see how he went from kind of a very general, high level, all inclusive meeting, which is a typical CCP meeting that kind of covers everything, leaves out nothing, to a very targeted, specific priorities for 2023. So that's what I came up with after I did the comparison. Okay. All right, let me see. Oh, I already talked about that. So that's his priority number one. Yeah, so he obviously, I think this is in sync with what we have seen. Number one, he is facing serious economic challenges, domestically, the unemployment, right? Unemployment, particularly among young people, and local government debts, the financial situations, at the local government level. And the other problem that I think the local government budget issue is a bigger challenge is, how the local government relies on central government transfer payments to balance its budget. So the local government, unless you are Shanghai, I think Shanghai was the only direct city or one of the provinces that was able to balance its book without the help from the central government. That's before 2021. All other municipalities need some sort of central government payment to balance its budget. So for a lot of the provinces, that's why they don't have the incentive to balance their budget. They know they're going to rely on the central government. So that's why if you watch my video from yesterday, I showed you how some people got wealthy during zero COVID, right? Zero COVID become a milk cow for some of the local governments personally. So the local government have no incentive to balance its book because they know they will never be able to. They will always rely on the central government transfer payment. So they may as well, you want me to do zero COVID? Okay, I'm going to spend money. And it's not my fault that I can't balance my budget. You need to pay for everything that you told me to do. So that's why I think this financial problem is really growing out of control because of that kind of central government, local government relation. And the reason because of that is there's a disproportionate, the central government receives more tax revenue, but the local government shares more expenditures. So there, by design, the central government pays less, but controls more revenue. So the central government use that kind of setup to control the local government, but then that also causes the local governments having no incentive to balance its budgets. So that's why I think the local government debt will really become a serious problem for Xi Jinping because, people at the local level don't care. And he knows that, right? So that's his challenge number one. And you could see the difference in its language between December last year and December this year. That's his priority number one, to deal with the economy. His challenge number two, we've already talked about that in my live stream on December 6th. Let me go back to, here we go. In this live, when I talk about Hu Jintao is back, this is the video where I talk about, there's an interview that this political dissident gave, where he talked about the infighting between the Jiang Zemin's family and Zheng Qinhong with Xi Jinping over Jiang Zemin's funeral. I'm not going to elaborate on that, but part of that fight, part of that interview or what this guy disclosed is the fact that Xi Jinping has a list of 15,000 people, followers, who are called the Jiang faction. You know, he has a list of that, and plus 3,000 private business owners who are bagmen, who kind of run the business for the government officials. And these people, the total wealth of these people amounts to the total GDP, China's total GDP. So it's this faction, the Jiang Zemin faction, is enormously wealthy. So here you have the Jiang family. The two men on the left are his two sons, his first oldest son, on the far left, Jiang Mianheng, and then his second son, Jiang Miankang, in the center, and then his two grandchildren, the grandson who started his venture capital firm at the age of 24 and made I don't know how many. He is the one who hold the mass majority of the Jiang family's wealth overseas, right? He recently moved his company from Hong Kong to Singapore, Boyu Capital, to try to prevent the situation, because Hong Kong is still technically China. So if Xi Jinping wants to investigate their business in Hong Kong, it's not so good. So he moved the company to Singapore. So this family is rumored to have, you know, the wealth between 500 billion to 1 trillion. That's rumor. We can't confirm that. It's impossible to confirm, but they are extremely wealthy. They have control over China's financial sectors, the telecom sectors. So think about all that money, right? Xi Jinping is in need of money. So taking down this political faction not only means striking down their political influence and take out the troublemakers, but also means he could have access to all this wealth, all this money he desperately needs. So so then that brings us to the second priority. So let's now compare the language between 2021 and 2022 in terms of how Xi Jinping will carry out this political cleansing, right? So if you look at the language in 2021, it's basically very general, adhere to the strategic policy of the anti-corruption. And if you really read that, everything is about building the tools or building the institutional tools to prevent corruption from happening or to limit the scale of corruption, like raise awareness, punish to warn, right? Develop system constraints, achieve greater governance effectiveness. I mean, everything is about building better guardrails to control corruption. But if you look at 2022, I mean, the language completely changed. So for example, overall, he said, we must fight the hard and lasting battle of anti-corruption in the spirit of complete self-revolution. And then he said, the party's top priority is to investigate and punish those who have not converged since the 18th Party Congress. What's special about the 18th Party Congress? That's the year when he became the CCP leader. That's 10 years ago. So he's saying that, well, we're going to fight this battle really hard. We're going to take out anyone who has still been who has not stopped their corruption since I, you know, came to power, right, 10 years ago. So he's sending that message loud and clear. And if you look at the details, it's even more clear. He said, investigate and deal with corruption cases where political and economic issues are intertwined. Rectify the corruption areas in which power is concentrated, capital is intensive, and resources are rich. What he's saying, he's going to focus on the corruption at the highest leadership level, right? Because the power is concentrated, capital is intensive, and resources are rich. So he's saying that very clearly. I'm coming after you guys, right? And then he's also saying, I'm going to, by greedy flies, you know, he used the word tigers and flies when he talked about the corrupt officials. The big tigers refer to the high-ranking government officials. The little flies refer to the grassroots corrupt officials. So he's coming after the big tigers in bullet number two on the left, under 2022 column, but he's also coming after the greedy flies at the grassroots level. So he wants to eradicate the breeding ground for corruption. So he's coming after everyone. And then he said he's going to improve the party and state supervision system to let it play the role of a political sword, right? He's using the word political sword. There's no leniency. And then we will strike out any air of extravagance, enjoyment, and entertainment, the three E's. You know how the corrupt, the CCP officials are corrupt. I mean, you know, they live a good life, right? I mean, this is not just money, right? Women, I mean, all sorts of corruption. I mean, he can't really use those words, but he's saying extravagance, enjoyment, entertainment, all of that. But we know what he's referring to. And then we will strictly investigate and punish those who violate the rules. So it's very, very clear. If you compare the language from 2022 to 2021, I mean, it's loud and clear. He seriously is meaning it. So with that said, I think we should expect 2023 to be a year of a lot of fun. I want to share with you this picture. The caption said, can you see the caption? Oh, here we go. The caption said, this was a picture taken on March 15th, 2008. This is Zheng Qinhong and Xi Jinping at the two sessions. You know, this is the CCP's the People's Conference and the Political Consultative Conference that they hold in the spring after the Party Congress in the fall. And that year, Xi Jinping joined the Politburo. He was established as the heir to Hu Jintao. He still looked young, but his political enemy, Zheng Qinhong, I mean, they sat next to each other. And I think this picture is worth a thousand words, right? So I think Jiang Zemin has died. The de facto leader of the Jiang faction is Zheng Qinhong. So I think the two will continue the ugly political fight. And then I think 2023 will be an eventful year. So that's all I will say. That's the end of my presentation. Let me see if people have any questions for me. All right. All right, thank you. Let me see. For Michael Masek, bonds are the biggest black swan on this planet. When they go, it's over. Good point. Thank you. Thank you for the donation. Let's see. Let me go through the super chats first. Wow, a lot of comments today. All right. Okay. Let me see. Let me see. Do I have any questions? COVID infections throughout Beijing. Serious risks, thoughts? Yeah. The infection, like, within days, it's like Beijing is the hard hit city, right? I mean, the government is hiding it. I mean, if you look at the official numbers, it's ridiculous. So people are saying everywhere that people, like their colleagues, their neighbors, their families are getting fevers, and there's right now a shortage of over the counter drugs. People are trying to buy Tylenol and, you know, drugs to reduce fevers, but they can't reach them. And then you see long lines of people waiting outside the hospitals. And I heard that the infection among medical professionals are also high in Beijing. So people worry that there's a medical, you know, the medical system meltdown. If that happens, it will be dreadful. So it is happening, and I think it happened because China did not prepare any, did not, it just, you know, opened up suddenly, and you know, so the country has not prepared for its 1.3 billion people for this. So the incident rate will be high, and there will be a lot of people, you know, getting COVID. And I think, and there's also a lack of public education, because people still fear of COVID. And so that the high incidence plus public panic, and also the medical, because China's medical system, it does not have the same number of beds. I think the number of beds it has, the number of ICU units per 100,000 people is only, what, 1/9 of that of the United States. It's very low. So, and then it's such a large country. And if you have a small number of people getting COVID and needs intensive care, and that could crash the medical, that could crash the hospitals. And so that's, I think, what we should watch carefully. How would the CCP handle that? There are people who said that Xi Jinping may use that against his political enemy to say, see, I told you zero COVID wasn't bad, right? I mean, he could have said that. We don't know what would happen. But for right now, I think it's just terrible for Chinese people, because they're not prepared for this sudden reopening. And there's no public education, and this panic is causing unnecessary human suffering and even casualties. So I just feel really just very terrible for the Chinese people who are going through that. I don't think the government would do anything. I mean, its hands are tied. What would it do, right? But it's real. And I think it's not just Beijing. The focus is on the capital city for sure, because it has more political implication, but it's everywhere in China. So in the past, where the CCP would like kind of consolidate medical professionals from other regions to send them to like Wuhan in 2020 and then to Shanghai earlier this spring, now they cannot do that because this outbreak is everywhere throughout China. So the medical professionals are needed in their local cities. So people just have to deal with it on their own. And I think the central government is not doing anything. It can't do anything. So will that cause social instability or even political instability? We should keep our eyes on that. It's possible. It depends on how much of a public panic there is. All right. Let me see. Thank you, Venkat. Thank you. Your poor AF. I saw an article that said China bought $300 billion worth of gold. I read that too. Yeah, I know it's secret. There was a mysterious, somebody who mysteriously bought, yeah, the bulk of gold. And then they pinpointed to China. Oh, I think it's isn't yeah, it's trying to be less dependent on the dollar, isn't it? So it's buying more gold. But I think that the country that has the largest gold reserve is still the United States. So it will take China a while to catch up on that. I think, yeah, the United States gold reserve is much bigger. Russia also has a huge gold reserve. Hu Jintao will rise again. I doubt it. I doubt it because he was a weak leader even when he was in power. You think Xi Jinping will let him take? And also, I think Hu Jintao probably no longer has the political aspiration to do it. All right, from Dieter Andrew, King Gold, 28 tons fake gold 2 years ago. Sorry, I'm not familiar with that, so I'm not able to make any comment. And okay, here we have a, is Chinese vaccines, if Chinese vaccines actually worked, then China should have opened up back in spring. No, the vaccines does not work, do not work. Yeah, and that's why we're seeing such a huge, surge in cases. All right. There have been many articles that have been tracking the quiet purchase of mRNA vaccine by China. Yeah, they're buying that for the privileged people, the government officials, and the wealthy people who can afford it. And they're not a small number, right? Like I said, China has 1.3 billion people, and if like 100 million people are really considered the wealthy, the affluent ones. So let's say 50 million people want to have access to Western vaccines and they have the money and they're important to the regime. The CCP will buy that for them. And then and 50 million is not a small number, right? I mean, for China, it's a small percentage of its population, but for pharma, that's not a small order. So of course China is buying, the Western vaccines. All right. Oh, somebody said China has bought up to 100 million mRNA. Yeah, like I said, they have 100 million people that are considered truly wealthy or affluent. So that's the market. All right. I have heard from Philance Williams, I have heard reports that the CCP was destroying Christian churches recently. That has been going on for a while, for a number of years. The underground churches have been systematically destroyed for the past for many years. That has been ongoing. All right. All right, so I think I've answered all the questions. It's Saturday night. Thank you for joining me. I think I will stop here. I'm going to enjoy the rest of my Saturday evenings. I hope you enjoy the rest of your weekend as well. All right, so have a great day or have a great evening, and I'll see you next time. Okay, bye-bye.